how many of you have heard Dr. Winakur speaking before? Well, so the one that we had the privilege before, know that it is a pleasure, a privilege to have a wonderful geriatrician among us, speaking always about something exciting. So you could read pages and pages. I'm going to summarize it, but Dr. Winakur graduated from the University of Pennsylvania long time ago, but he got a lot of wisdom. I'm not going to say the age. He did internal medicine here in our institution and has practiced over 40 years.
Well, 36.
36 years, and just decided to teach Morse and retire from direct patient care. My suspicion is I don't know how long it will last, but we will see. He is a certified medical director for long-term care, which is a special certification the American Medical Directors Association gives to doctors that do more expertise in long-term care. And has been working a lot with the students for the past, 10 years in the medical humanities. So many of you have the privilege to work with him in those settings. In 2005, Dr. Winakur wrote an incredible piece called What Are We Going to Do With That? In the Health Affairs Magazine journal published that, and it generated an incredible national discussion that I really believe has helped for healthcare reform and the dialogue about what happened with the complexity on older adults. So we are excited that he, started that dialogue. PBS also has done exciting work with him about the Diane Ring Show, Fresh Air, Lifetimes. So this big, wonderful media has been, Dr. Winakur has been an ambassador of geriatrics in that area. And you have a recent memoir manifesto called Memory Lessons, A Doctor's Story. You should get that in your library. And it was published in 2009, right. Correctly? So what a privilege, Dr. Winakur. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you so much. Pleasure to be here again. And we have a small select group, and that's wonderful. I'm going to use the opportunity to be rather informal about this presentation. So I'm here today to talk to you about sort of three interrelated subjects. And let me get this up here. So what is successful aging? And what do we mean when we use the term resilience? And finally, what is creative resilience? And I got interested in these questions for a variety of reasons. The obvious one, of course, is that after being an internist and a geriatrician for so many years, I had to ask myself this question constantly, which is, why did some of my
patients... Someone has entered the conference.
Do so well and live so long despite multiple comorbidities, while others of my patients seem to succumb quickly. And I had to say, well, what's at work here? It can't all be genetics, it can't all be immunology, it can't all be lifestyle, it can't even all be herbal supplements. But as a doctor, I've had a disease-oriented approach to my patients. I always said, it was the cancer, it was the heart failure, it was the emphysema, it was the dementia that took my patient. But after doing this for a long time, after getting old myself, to a lot of you I'm old, and then, of course, watching my father die of Alzheimer's disease, I really feel like there's much more to what makes someone age successfully than their physiology. And those of us that see a lot of patients, and we've been in the clinical practice side of medicine for a long time, we get a little smug about it. We think maybe if we could just sit down with someone for a few minutes and look at them, we can tell this patient is aging well, or this patient isn't aging well. Some of us even believe we can make that kind of distinction just based on a photograph. And I'm going to show you some photographs today. And many of them were taken by this gentleman, Jeffrey Levine, who's a geriatrician and an award-winning photographer out of Manhattan, and we became friends a number of years ago when we met at a American Medical Directors Association meeting. And he's actually gone around the country, he's actually gone around the world taking photographs of aging individuals. So, and by the way, I don't know if any of you saw this, but last year in the Briscoe Library of the Medical School, they had an exhibition of his called Aging Across America. I don't know if any of you got to see it, but it was, a lot of these photographs are coming from that exhibition. So let's look at one of his photographs. So here we have, you know, he doesn't look real old, but he's got gray hair, maybe a little pot belly, and here he is in a rodeo charging on his stallion. I think we, most of us would look at that and say this is a man that's aging well. You may not know why, but he looks like he's aging well. And here are a couple of elderly Jewish scholars studying the great book, the Talmud, together. They look elderly, but they're intent, they look passionate, they're studying together. I'd say, and I think most of us would probably say, these are two men who appear to be aging well. So if we look at a number of studies in the literature that have described successful aging, here's some of their criteria that they use to describe successful aging. Being free of major chronic conditions, or the absence of disease, the ability to function independently, the absence of physical impairments, the upper 20% of individuals who retain the most vigorous physical functioning, the absence of physiological decline, having no more than one disease with high physical function, being free of cardiovascular disease, cancer, or COPD with intact physical and cognitive function. So these are definitions in the clinical medical literature when they're trying to tease out who is aging successfully. They've used primarily, you'll note that these definitions tend to focus only on physiological deficits as barriers to successful aging. And after 40 years of research, roughly corresponds with my career in medicine, most constructs that are out there today on successful aging are still unidimensional. And there is really no consensus on a standard definition of what is successful aging. So maybe we ought to look at centenarians, you know, centenarians, people who live to be 100 years old or older. Let's look at some centenarian studies. 40 to 50% of centenarians are demented. One-third need assistance to eat, 50% to toilet, two-thirds assistance to dress. The mean number of illnesses was 4.3. And only 12% of centenarians, at least in this Denmark study of 207 of them, were non-demented and functioned well physically and were living at home. So I'm not sure that centenarians are where we look necessarily for successful aging. There may be something else going on there with centenarians. But if you look at these figures, a lot of them are really not aging successfully. They've gotten old, but they aren't aging successfully. So healthy centenarians do not exist, but autonomous centenarians do. And I think the autonomy issue is one that's important. So centenarian studies, they have demonstrated that it's inherently difficult, if not impossible, to reach advanced age, yet remain free of comorbid conditions and some degree of disability. Yet despite these changes, functional adaptation and autonomy may still be attainable. So we all age differently. There are multiple pathways to successful aging. And perhaps it is possible to age successfully as long as individuals can compensate in some way for the deficits and limitations on individual physiologies. So let's look at some compensatory psychosocial mechanisms of aging. Emotional vitality, however you want to define it. Resilience, and we're going to talk more about that. Coping, optimization, spirituality, and there's one at the bottom that didn't get on here. Social ties, very important one. Both giving and receiving social support. What's on here? It's not on here. So in this model, psychological and or social mechanisms can help us compensate for our physiological decline, allowing some of us to age successfully while others of us do not. So here's kind of a new model that was presented in JAMDA just a year or so ago, and it kind of looks like this. You got these three major domains, a physiological domain, we talked about, disease and impairments, a psychological domain, which would include emotional vitality and resilience, and a sociological domain, which is engaging with life and spirituality, having social connections. So in this model, these areas of overlap become highly important because it's in these areas of overlap where successful aging can occur even with physiological impairments or psychological impairments or sociological impairments. It's in these areas of overlap where a patient can still achieve a sense of well-being, a high self-assessed quality of life, and a sense of personal fulfillment, even in the context of age, of illness and disability. And this model also implies a kind of a graded continuity to successful aging, rather than a dichotomous model where you're either aging well or you're not aging well, you're either physiologically healthy or you're not. In this model, a person can be on some sort of a gradient of successful aging. So, on the psychological domain, as we've seen, one of the compensatory mechanisms of successful aging is resilience. So let's talk about resilience a little bit. So here's a wonderful photograph of Jeff Levine's. This is a Tuskegee Airman. You all know about the Tuskegee Airmen. There's just actually a film about them recently. It's a Tuskegee Airman and his grandson. And, he looks perhaps like he could be a little frail. But then again, he's got the support of his grandson with him, obviously to take him to this reunion of the Tuskegee Airmen. So we might consider him resilient. What about this woman? It's a woman in New York City. Look at her. She's playing the harmonica. She's got her mobility device decorated with little angels. She's got a little collection container there. It says raising money for medical bills, those of you who can't read what her little sign is. If you walk by her on the street casually, maybe you wouldn't necessarily feel that she was aging particularly well. I mean, there's this poor woman on the street trying to collect money, but yet, look at what she's put together. Look how she's put herself together. Maybe we would say she would be resilient. So what do we mean by resilience? What's the clinical definition? What's the medical or psychosocial definition? You know, the concept of resilience, and I'm not going to talk about the microbiological definition of resilience, because there's people writing about resilience almost at the cellular level now. We're not going to talk about that. But let's talk about these other definitions. The concept of resilience in the literature has been around really for a long time, but actually 85% of literature on the subject of resilience and aging has appeared in just the last 10 years. And just as with successful aging, there's no generally accepted model of resilience, but I'm going to give you a few working definitions that came from this recent text, came out in 2011. Resnick and Al edited it, and I have a contribution in this book called Resilience and Aging, Concepts, Research, and Outcomes. And there were the book is divided into a number of chapters, and a number of authors with different perspectives kind of weighed in. And here are some of their definitions of resilience. Resilience is a dynamic process of maintaining positive adaptation and effective coping strategies in the face of adversity. Resilience is an extraordinary and positive response to a challenge or stressor. Resilient older adults are able to tolerate the vicissitudes of aging and defray the overhead of getting old. Almost an economic definition, isn't it? Kind of a summary definition by Barbara Resnick herself after putting this book together is this one. Resilience is conceptualized to reflect an effective response to some type of adversity or challenge, whether it be physical, psychological, economic, political, environmental, or social. So you may be asking yourself this question, and it's asked in the literature, but is resilience a dynamic process, or is it a character trait? That is a controversy in the literature, and it does contribute to a lack of clarity in the definition. Because as some will define resilience as a dynamic process, some person in the world, either in their psychological or social realm, actively doing something that contributes to their resiliency, or are they just born that way? Is it genetic in some way? Some do define it as an individual difference, characteristic, an ability to successfully cope with change or misfortune. Resilient individuals are described as self-confident, to know their own strengths and limitations. And although they can regain and some equilibrium after a period of adversity or change, they don't really necessarily regain their previous level of performance or functioning. And this group, Wagnild, has actually developed a resilience scale. They developed it through interviews with who they felt to be resilient individuals, and they do identify five themes of resiliency, including equanimity, perseverance, self-reliance, existential aloneness, which is reveling in one's own uniqueness, and spirituality and meaningfulness, which enables the individual to draw conclusions as to why events occur and embrace the need for change, flexibility, and growth. Some of this work can be summarized with this quote from a piece by Langer in 2004 about older adults. Older adults have life experience that result in significant strengths and capabilities, allowing for successful coping with the multiple adversities they may encounter. This is more of a developmental approach, you know, that as we age, we have life experiences, and we develop behaviors and thoughts and feelings. We develop specific emotional and perhaps spiritual mechanisms to help us cope with the adversities of aging. And maybe this is really, at bottom, what resilience is all about. It's not so much a genetic issue. Again, this is, I'm gonna skip over this. We've already talked about some of these domains: physiological, social support, emotional, spiritual. So perhaps one application of the science that's developing about resilience may be to help us identify interventions, such as life reviews or reminiscences with our patients, or other creative processes that tap into resilience and might stimulate or enhance it in order to facilitate successful aging. And this is my segue into a subset of the issue of resilience, and that is creative resilience in aging. The study of creative resilience is really just coming into its own. There's lots of anecdotal evidence that creativity can continue well into our oldest years, and then exercising the parts of our brain responsible for our creativity, for making those multiple synaptic connections that characterize us as humans, that those kinds of those kinds of exercises, creative exercises, and actually can enhance our daily lives and keep our minds sharp. The scientific basis for this, the why and the how, is still in its infancy, as you know. And they're working on it, doing a lot of work here at the bar shop, but it's still in its infancy. But it does appear that patients, even with mild to moderate dementias, can not only participate in creative acts that bring them fullness and joy, they can also appreciate the creative acts of others in a way and to a degree that we've not really realized heretofore. So let's begin with some examples of the creative powers of some well-known members of our species. And I take a lot of these examples from this wonderful book by Dr. Gene Cohen. A lot of you may know Dr. Cohen's work. He's the former founding director of the National Institute of Aging and really a groundbreaking researcher in the field of mental health and aging. So does anybody know what this is? Or who the artist is? So this is Henri Matisse, who designed the stained glass for this Dominican chapel in Vence, France, at the age of 82. Here he is, still continuing to paint, bedridden, but still continuing to paint and draw. Who did this painting? Right. So this is Two Girls Reading by Pierre-Auguste Renoir. He was unable to walk as he neared the age of 70. His fingers were no longer supple, but despite this, he continued painting, attaching a paintbrush to his hand. The Washerwomen was created when he was 76. Anybody know who painted this? So this is Mary Cassatt, who's a renowned impressionist, American impressionist painter, who produced this painting, Fillette au Grand Chapeau, at age 64. Well, hell, she wasn't old. I'm 64. Who did this? So this is the Guggenheim Museum. Who was the architect? Frank Lloyd Wright completed the design of this museum, which is in New York City, at the age of 91, the year he died. You all know who this is. And Einstein, at the age of 74, produced his 1953 paper on the meaning of relativity, which included his controversial unified field theory. Imagination is more important than knowledge, he once said. Anybody know who this is? Excuse me?
Eleanor Roosevelt.
No? Yeah, it looks a little like her. Well, these are all the same, this picture of the same woman. This is Dame Agatha Christie, who wrote up until she died at age 86. Her books have sold more than 100 million copies. Who's this? This is Tolstoy, who lived to be 82 and was productive until the end. And he had a quote that I really like. He said, "I remembered very vividly that I am conscious of myself in exactly the same way now at 81 as I was conscious of myself, my I, at 5 or 6 years of age. Consciousness is immovable." And if you talk to enough elderly patients, you will realize they almost all feel the same way. Anybody know who this is? That's Robert Frost. Robert Frost published one of his many books of poetry, In the Clearing, at the age of 88. And how about this man from our field? This is Albert Schweitzer, who received the Nobel Peace Prize for his work as a medical missionary in Africa at age 77, after completing his autobiography, My Life and Thought, at age 74. Here's Gene Cohen and his own dad, 91-year-old father, playing cribbage together. Here are a couple of quotes from Dr. Cohen. "Creative potential is there in all of us, an inner resource, renewable and vibrant no matter how much or how little it is used. This creative spirit has the power to change our lives at every age, and to do so in quite different ways as we get older. His extensive work in this field has led him to summarize four aspects of creativity. Creativity strengthens our morale in later life. Creativity allows us to alter our experience of problems and sometimes to transcend them in later life. Creativity makes us more emotionally resilient and better able to cope with life's adversity and losses. Creativity contributes to physical health as we age. A positive outlook and a sense of well-being have a beneficial effect on the functioning of our immune system, and there's more and more real scientific evidence for this and overall health. Creativity enriches relationships. Adult children with optimistic expectations of aging typically are more comfortable discussing issues of aging and other life passages with their parents. Creativity is our greatest legacy. To be creative in later life provides an invaluable model of what is possible as we age. Creativity has distinguished elders as keepers of the culture, those who pass the history and values of family and community on to the next generation. Well, you know, at some level, I think all of us know this, but if we look around at today's world objectively, especially in regard to the rising ageism in our culture, I think you'll agree with these words written more than 10 years ago by Gene Cohen. Creativity has always been there with aging, but many have not recognized or searched for it in themselves in later life because society has so denied, trivialized, or maligned it with advancing years. You know, as geriatricians, you know, we appreciate people that will speak frankly to issues like this. And Dr. Cohen and many others have a lesson for policymakers. To recognize the potential for creative expression independent of age is more likely to bring policymakers to the table, not with a sense of skepticism or cynicism about what is possible, but with a new sense of opportunity, challenge, and one hopes, creativity. To think about older adults primarily in terms of decline and disability, or to view them as a national burden, is to overlook their value as a national resource of exceptional potential. So, as was mentioned, and I wrote this book about my life as a geriatrician, which arose out of helping to care for my own father during his 7-year decline from his Alzheimer's disease. And my interest in creative resilience in particular grew out of my caregiving experience with him as well. And after a hospitalization for heart failure complicated by delirium at age 80, my father was never the same. But I discovered this when I visited him, even during the worst times of his paranoia and belligerency. If I pulled out one of his old art books — my father was a painter with a lifelong history in art history — if I pulled out one of his books and sat down next to him, the book opened across our laps. As I began to turn the pages, he would become engrossed. "Oh, I've always loved that one," he might say. This was one of his favorites, this Gauguin painting. Interesting, not only because of it as a beautiful painting, but the words that are written across it, which is, you know, who are we, where are we going? I mean, they're kind of existential questions for all people. So I was heartened and amazed, really, at this simple act of sitting down with my father while he looked at these famous paintings that had thrilled him and inspired him over the course of his life, could transform him and alter his mood completely, calm his agitation, his belligerency. And I really wasn't aware then — this would have been in the late 90s, early 2000s, I really wasn't aware of the body of scientific work that was slowly building this resiliency in aging, using the arts to promote resiliency among persons with dementia and their caregivers. Much of the work is summarized in Chapter 7 of that Resnick book that I showed you earlier. And as I came to understand with my own father, it's been observed for many years by both clinicians and caregivers that individuals with Alzheimer's disease seem to respond positively to artistic engagement, with behavioral changes such as increased smiling and improved moods and diminished agitation. And this growing body of converging research demonstrate how artistic engagement can be an important tool for improving quality of life and diminishing the problem behaviors, and perhaps even to improve some aspects of cognitive functioning in individuals with dementia. These artistic activities include drawing, music, and dance, and I've got a lot of references on that if anybody's interested. And I'm going to kind of skip over a lot of that and kind of concentrate on the visual arts. As an aside, I'll say that some of the scientific work in dementias, particularly Alzheimer's disease, has shown that artists, painters particularly, that develop dementia, tend to show an increase in the abstraction of their artwork and decreased precision in color scheme as their disease process progresses. And it's interesting. Here's an early self-portrait by my father. There he is. Sorry, you guys.
Can you see it?
Oh, you do see it, okay. There's an early self-portrait, and here's a late self-portrait. And to me, it does. Now, you know, you might say, well, maybe he was trying a different style, but I think in this one he was definitely developing his dementia. So there's a woman named Ann Davis Basting who's worked in the applied arts with people in the mid to late stages of dementia for 15 years or so. She says, at the moment, the core challenge in demonstrating the resilience of older adults with disabilities is the attitudes of their care providers. And here's a really interesting groundbreaking program called Meet Me at MoMA. MoMA is the Metropolitan Museum of Modern Art in Manhattan. So the Meet Me at MoMA project is where professionals, caregivers, and patients come together in an effort to enhance resiliency, not only for those with the Alzheimer's disease, but for the rest of us engaged in the process. In 2006, Francesca Rosenberg harnessed the collections at the museum in an attempt to strengthen responses to aging and stress. She designed MoMA's Alzheimer's Disease Project. She writes, Alzheimer's is a progressive illness that impacts not only memory, thinking, and behavior, but also affects work, lifelong hobbies, and or one's social life. Alzheimer's also adversely affects caregivers who often experience depression, increased anxiety, stress, and have less time to tend to their own lives. The MoMA has found that looking at all kinds of visual art can positively impact both caregivers and care recipients. So the program is a monthly program that featured features interactive tours of the museum's collections for individuals in the early and middle stages of their dementing illness, along with family members and caregivers, for the singular purpose of providing them an expressive outlet and forum for dialogue through guided tours and discussions in the galleries during non-public hours. Specially trained museum educators engage participants during a tour of 4 or 5 artworks related to a theme and presented in a predetermined sequence. Each tour lasts about 1.5 hours, with 15 to 20 minutes spent on each artwork. Several discussion questions are posed to engage participants in observing, describing, interpreting, and connecting to the works and to each other. Art looking as well as art making provides mental stimulation and learning possibilities, as well as an outlet to spark expression and creative interpretation. You all know who did this. After viewing Van Gogh's The Starry Night, patient and patron Elaine Gold said, "The houses looked like they were very close to each other, and it touches you deeply. There's a life force in it, like something being born." Bella Fogel reported after looking at Rousseau's Sleeping Gypsy that she was thrilled to see the line. Again, these are patients with modern Alzheimer's disease. Ruth Krauss said that Picasso was a study of distortion. Francesca Rosenberg said this about the patrons. What we've noticed is that there is an awakening. They're really coming alive before our eyes. For many of them, they are able to make connection to memories, thoughts they haven't been able to get hold of for a very, very long time. So what's happening here? That's another painting by my dad, my mother, from a long time ago. Art can tap into one's long-term emotional memories, feelings he or she has had relating to events and people in their lives. Looking at art puts patient and caregiver on a level playing field. Both can engage with the work at various levels and feel validated and empowered. This is my father's only grandson, Adam. Art can be a tool for communication, thereby enabling human and social connection and understanding between patient and caregiver, and between patients and caregivers and other caregivers. Art offers the means to make connections between individual experience and the world at large. And after I read that quote, I remembered that my father was very moved by bomb damage in Beirut during one of the wars there. And this was a black and white photograph that was in a newspaper. And he painted a painting from that. It's hard to see, but there's a man in the middle panel, toward the middle, kind of sitting hunched over a table. There's another side. I want to mention that Professor Craig Klugman, the bioethicist at the Center for Medical Humanities and Ethics, he's developed a program in collaboration with the McNay here in town, in which he takes medical and nursing students to view certain artworks in order to hone the observation skills of these students. And anybody know about that program involved in it? So the New York University Center of Excellence for Brain Aging and Dementia actually got involved in this Meet Me at MoMA study and did some work. In collaboration with them. Their hypothesis is that people with early stage dementia and their family caregivers would report decreased social isolation and enhanced self-esteem, fewer symptoms of depression, improved mood, and enhanced quality of life. And they spent time observing these individuals, interviewing them, monitoring the time that they spent looking at the artwork. Here's the mood of caregivers reflected by smiley faces, pre-program and post-program. Here's a graph looking at the amount of time participants spent looking at the artwork. Participants spent even more time looking at the works of art, and the viewing time only increased as the works were shown in turn. These were the participants, and these were, this was the participants looking at the educator, and these were the actual time the participants spent looking at the works of art. And you see they're really getting more interested as the time goes on. So it's a small study, but I believe that it holds some lessons for all of us, doctors and families and caregivers and patients. You know, the importance, so important that this be set up right. The educator's role is very important. The intellectual stimulation that you provide is important. The fact that it's a shared experience and their social interactive action is important. That it's an accepting environment. That there's emotional carryover, not just during the time, but even the next day and even longer. And the program actually was felt to have such a positive effect that almost all the caregivers plan to return with their loved one with dementia.
I have a couple of questions. How they choose the artwork, what was behind that? And second, did particular paintings were more effective, or did the therapeutic value.
I can't tell you. I can't tell you exactly how they chose them, but I know that they chose them for more the questions they might raise.
Oh, I see.
They had. They had to have tell a story, mm-hmm. and they had to be obviously very visually
engaging.
Cool. And I think that was really one of the. It took art educators to determine which of the paintings they might use. So it was really a collaborative project among a lot of people, but I think it was another great example of the care team. Mm-hmm. I mean, how many of our care teams have art educators on them? But it's another extension of the care team, isn't it? And these things, you know, these things can be done not only in museum, but imagine taking a presentation like this into a long-term care institution.
I was going to say about the nursing homes.
I don't know of any work in that regard, but I know that taking the local museums developing programs like this, if you Google this, you're going to find at least a dozen across the country that are doing it, including the McMahon has a similar program here. So, that's my father and me in 1999, right at the cusp of when our trouble starts to begin. And he has his little dog, which, you know, there's literature on pets, too, and how they can help engage our patients, our elderly patients, especially those with dementia. So my dad died in 2006, well, 6 years ago, and I still think about him every day, and, you know, I'm angry with Alzheimer's disease. The day that he couldn't remember my name, I don't think I'll ever forget. But, you know, when I think about him now, and I think about him in terms of some of these studies that I've read about creative resilience, you know, I have to say that he was 87 years old when he died. And he had a lot of medical issues. He had heart failure, he had prostate cancer, aside from his dementia. He had a history of depression in his life. But he was 87. And he painted really up to a few years before he died. And I have to conclude that in the end, he was really saved by his art. Because one of the reasons is the practice of his art gave him a new identity. You know, he wasn't any longer a failed shopkeeper, and I talk about that a lot in the book. He lost his business when he was 50 years old, and really never, that was always the fact that he never could be productive again in terms of earning money was always a theme in his later years. But he identified himself as an artist. And the message for all of us in this is that when we're failing physically and cognitively, dipping into the well of our own personal creative resilience buoys us. We don't have to paint.
No.
We can draw, we can read, we can create, we can tell stories. And I think it's an important lesson as we prepare for my generation and we're involved with caring for patients. You know, intervening to stimulate and build resilience. Of course, we want to talk about maintaining vigor and physical robustness and improve socialization practices, but strengthening self.
Your conference is scheduled to end in 5 minutes.
Right on time. Improve, but strengthening self-efficacy and self-esteem and motivation through interpersonal interactions, as well as experiences, are very helpful. Optimizing resilience, I mentioned a bunch of these already, using narrative, social remembering, encouraging creativity, encouraging spirituality when appropriate. So who's here's a couple more photographs. Who would you say is aging more successfully? Who is more resilient? This is the elder New York Marathon. And you know, look at that man in the front, a couple of men in the front. And that woman, 337. You know, they're running, they're toned.
Great legs.
Are they more resilient? Do you think they're more resilient now that we've talked about a little bit about what we know about resiliency? think they're more resilient than this lady. She's probably in a long-term care facility, but she's comfortable, she's smiling, there's a caregiver, maybe that's her daughter, with her. Is there some psychosocial realm of aging that perhaps makes her as resilient in some way as the marathon runners? So all of us taking care of the elderly, you know, we know that there's an overwhelming and paramount need to promote social aging. In this, particularly in this time of fiscal austerity, and it's probably going to be that way forever now in our country, we have to better understand successful aging. But I want to submit, and I hope I've been able to talk about that in this talk, promote that in my talk, that we can't tell by a snapshot in time who is aging successfully and who isn't. To do this really takes meaningful interactions with our patients and their caregivers, an inquiry into their lives, in order to evaluate their life circumstances in more than one domain. And we tend to do it on the physiological domain, which is not enough. Again, remember this slide. Are there tools? Is there a tool for successful aging? Is there an assessment tool? Well, there have been things that have been developed, but I don't think there's anything that really evaluates successful aging on all three domains. I think this really is something that work that still needs to be done. Let's talk about a verifiable tool. You know, we've got some pieces of a verifiable tool.
Your conference is scheduled to end in 2 minutes.
You're fine. 15 more minutes. Right. That's for the video conference.
You know, we know about, there's a lot of physiological performance measurements, like gait speed. Anybody here, Dr. Studensky? I mean, there are physical performance measurements, get up and go, gait speed. There are a number of those. The psychological domain, maybe that can be integrated. You know, the MMSE, the Geriatric Depression Scale. There is even some tools on the sociological domain, like the Spirituality Index of Well-being. Be great if we could integrate these, because if we can integrate these, what would be the use of a verifiable, successful aging assessment tool? Well, for one, it could help us perform a more holistic health assessment and identify patients who are aging successfully and those who could benefit from specific recommendations. It could help us draw out compensatory tactics in one or the other domains. Community health planners might use such an instrument to plan for services at the population level. Proactive programs, for example, to help elders develop new social ties, social skills, improve lifestyle choices. Here's another Jeff Levine photograph. The truly successful older individual is someone who has demonstrated resilience and at age 95, with multiple morbidities, optimizes function, volunteers, or continues to be actively engaged in meaningful
Your
activities.
Your conference time has now expired. Thank
you. Or simply happy reviewing his or her prior life activities. USS Jarvis went down at Pearl Harbor. It is the individual who has a hip fracture and engages fully in rehab activities and remains determined to return home, or the individual who recognizes cognitive changes with a decline in short-term memory and buys a bigger calendar to write more reminders or cues. So as geriatricians and members of the geriatric team, let us continue to expand our understanding of the domains of aging and how they interact, so that we may continue our best efforts on behalf of our patients. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm happy to answer some questions. Again, I probably won't know the answers, but I can give it my best shot.
Thank you for your presentation. Actually, I heard you at the Health Science Center when I bought your book, so I really loved your book. Thank you. I think what happens a lot of times is families have a hard time understanding how to engage their family members with dementia. And I've seen this with my mother's 88 and she's in moderate stage of Alzheimer's, and when we found out she was getting it, I said, we need to get her into a program. And fortunately in El Paso they have the PACE program,
right.
And that saved her, I think, in terms of her involvement. And she wouldn't have been where she is now. She's very functional. She has no other illnesses at all. And she has 8 children who are, you know, constantly calling her and having contact with her and are involved. And when she comes to visit me here, I draw from her strengths, which is, I mean, she can sew a hole in a sock. She does a fantastic job. And I have her do that.
You have
and
a darning egg. You have a darning egg. Anybody know what a darning egg is?
No. Oh, yeah, darning egg. Got it. Okay. Yeah. And she's involved. And she does help me. You know, Mom, I have, you know, I constantly am washing clothes and I never can fold them. You know, so she's doing things that she can do. She has continuous, meaningful activity where she knows she's helping me. How can I help you? And so families, you know, my siblings, fortunately, I've been in aging for like 30 years now, and that's saved me. Understand this better and to know. So I was kind of advocating that I get her in. She's not going to go to center. She's not going to go. She's been a mom all her life. She's not going to go out. I said she's going to go there, you know. And so now she's been there for 4 years and she's doing amazing. So I think families need to have support from providers in terms of how to do that, because they don't know how to do this.
Exactly. I mean, I think, you know, one of the things I really liked about that museum program is that they had the caregivers in there, and the caregivers are learning too how to engage the person in their charge, be it their spouse or their daughter. So that's an important, education is very important. There's an interesting segment in this book on resilience and aging where someone uses the example of preparing a Thanksgiving meal, you know, traditionally a real family event, and how utilizing our elders in that event of planning and putting together a Thanksgiving meal as an example of a creative way to engage our elders and keep them engaged. So, you know, okay, it doesn't have to just be Thanksgiving, it can be other meals, but it's an interesting exercise. The other thing I want to say, from what I've read and heard about PACE programs, you know, they're terrific. You know, they're terrific. And I was at a conference at the University of Iowa. I was asked to speak there. And one of the speakers, I'm sorry I can't remember his name, maybe you'll know, but he was involved in a PACE program in Indiana. And he published several articles about it in JAMA.
Steve Council, maybe? He's
maybe,
in Indiana.
Maybe. And, you know, I talked with him afterwards because he was presenting all this really wonderful data. And I said, well, you know, tell me how you're taking care of these patients and providing these opportunities to all these elderly patients on a Medicare budget. And he laughed. He said, well, there's no way we could do it without the money, the grant money. So to me, as who's been a practicing geriatrician, I mean, let's face it, I'm a team member of one. You know, I don't have a geriatric team. It's me. I mean, when I need to get something for my patients, you know, I got to call the home health agency. I got to contact the rehab people and the RT people and the case manager. I'm the team. And these are all people in practice. They're not in my office. We're not all working together. We don't have team meetings. I said, how can a guy like me trying to practice geriatrics in the real world, how can I do this? Said, you can't do it. You can't do it. You can't do it on what Medicare is going to pay you as a doctor. Now, look, that model is changing now. And, you know, that model may change with accountable care organizations and medical homes. I hope it changes, because it's really the only way we're going to be able to take care of this incredible crush of elderly people in a way that's humane. And that can take care of them the way we want to take care of our own family members. There has to be a way that we can do it. But for most of us out in the world, we cannot do it. You know, you're real fortunate to have that program there. But for most of us, We can't do it, and our patients can't really afford the services that it would take to do it.
Dr. Winakur?
Yes.
You can't even prepare a Thanksgiving dinner on a Medicaid budget.
No.
And so ideas that we have for them is, that would be therapeutic aren't open to them. The food bank perhaps gives a ham at Christmas time, perhaps gives a turkey to some people at Thanksgiving time.
You're right. There are all these disparate agencies with good intentions. Good intentions. But unless there's some coordinated effort in a community to bring it all together, I think that we're missing out on major opportunities to help our elderly. Yes, ma'am.
And Dr. Sharon Lewis, she's a nurse researcher here also. And she has, I think, with others, developed the caregiver, right?
It's called the Boost Program.
Stress busters. So she's offered to have our nursing students sit with the patients when the caregivers bring the patients into the center. They're going for the different programs, but nursing students will sit with the patients with dementia. So this idea will arc. And now to explore that with her further, what using art also, what the students can do things to help improve communication with them, you know, with the patients with dementia. But I really like this idea, and she hasn't really discussed that with me yet, but I will ask her to look into this more so the students can use also these ideas about art on how to kind of promote that idea of, you know, resiliency of the patients.
You know, my idea, and I voiced it at the Center for Medical Humanities and Ethics, but I guess it's a matter of resources and funding. But, you know, my idea for our students, nursing students, medical students, health profession students, is that when they first come here, they get assigned a family or an individual, and for all the years that they're here, they are involved with that family medically, sociologically. They become the advocate for that family in the system. It's done in other places. It could be done. It just takes somebody who has the ear of the upper echelon folks in the Health Science Center to present an argument that this would be a really wonderful experience. So far, I don't know, I have any takers, but if anybody ever wants to put that together and wants me to be part of the presentation, I'd be happy to do it. Because I think it would be a wonderful experience for us.
We actually did it. It used to be called the visiting professor, and we assigned the third year medical students to an elderly couple or a patient that was a volunteer, and the program was extremely successful. Until one day the curriculum committee decided that they needed to switch gears, and the program got dropped. So we did it, it got published, it has pros and cons, you know, many elders felt a little bit left out. If the students come for a year and then they go, there is some grieving there, but the students learned to apply the geriatric assessment at home. They went and visited them and hear their stories and practice all of the things in the real world and interview them. But I agree with you, you need to have a sense that that's what your medical school should do, which is prepare for the current crisis of geriatrics.
Yeah, and start them in their first year. I think they'll learn more in their first year when they don't know anything.
Exactly.
And they have to learn.
Sure.
Then their third or fourth year, when they're already a little jaded by the process. Start them out early, but... Well,
we can revive it. I mean, I'm with you. We have tried, but, and again, I think the school is trying to do some components with the new curriculum reform, and, you know, we will see if that will allow for experiences like that. And I think the feedback, they're hearing feedback, so maybe this is the time to rebrand the ideas.
And of course, nursing would be, and we do something similar, but it's not continuous through all semesters.
So you do it too.
So we've started, but it needs, of course, the interprofessional piece would be absolutely wonderful.
I would love that. If a nurse could partner with a medical student, so you send
them.
Well, exactly.
And you know, this is another comment I wanted to make. We in geriatrics know how important the team is. Even though I didn't have a team as a privately practicing geriatrician, I knew how important it was that I had people that I could call in other disciplines. And I was the skilled, the founding medical director and the medical director for almost 10 years at the skilled nursing unit at Methodist Hospital before they decided it wasn't cost effective for them to have it anymore. So I really know how important the team is in geriatrics, and we all know that. As far as I know, there is only one medical school in America that puts first-year medical students in teams with other health professionals, and they carry these teams through their entire 4 years of medical school. Well, I mean, team care is going to be how we get this job done. It's the only way to get it done, and yet, maybe there is something like that going on here. If it is, I'm not aware of it. Where medical students, nursing students, health professional students, whatever, are getting together regularly, being presented cases, be they real or theoretical, and sitting down and talking about how they would go about together managing this case.
I think Dr. Patel is doing something like that. She wrote a grant with us involved also, with the PharmD in nursing and medicine, to do home visits for the patients who leave the ACE unit. So we're waiting to hear on whether that's going to be approved or not.
So would it just be a small sampling of, or the whole
so
class?
She will probably have a small sampling to start.
It's a third-year medical students, and the idea is to do that in a small scale.
Yeah.
And then expand
and
it.
And expand it later. But we're waiting to hear.
It's one of the UT grants.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's great that they're at least heading in that direction.
Let me add something. I have a few. I'm Michelle Cilio. You might have heard I'm from the Department of Surgery, so I know it's a little long. But I have a few comments and a question. One is the comment that you're bringing up the team. I actually, the VAs, this is their year, the subspecialty team based off the neighborhood groups, and they actually awarded our VA here, which I'm part of it, over $2 million in a grant for a team specialty care. Now, it doesn't involve the students, but it is involving primary care with the subspecialists, such as the surgeons, the GI doctors, to try to make seamless care for the patients, and especially have people following through the whole process and the communication back to the PAC system. And it's actually, they've had multiple grants awarded to about 14 VAs in the country, and it is a huge department, even within the VA department, called specialty care neighborhood groups. So actually the VA itself is very committed to that kind of thing. That's one comment. So that you will see that they are recognizing it on a large scale and seeing that as the future. And then the second comment I wanted to make, or I had a question and a comment. The question first would be, I would guess that our neuropsychologists and psychiatrists would be very interested in this right brain, left brain with the creativity. So I wanted to know if you had any feedback, or if that's been studied. I'm sure some of this has been brought back.
Yeah, and there's some information in this book about some of the neuroscience involved and functional MRIs and that sort of thing. But you know, that's really in its infancy, and it needs to be done relevant to day by day clinical geriatric care.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, but. But you're right. It is being done, and I'm sure the results will be helpful.
And then I had an observation. Just I was going to make a comment on. Might have missed something. But to the best of my knowledge, all the artists and writers that you showed were creative throughout their whole life.
Yes.
However, absent, and I found interesting, absent were two that I thought really would stick out in this kind of field. One would be Grandma Moses, who of course started in her 60s,
right.
And Mother Teresa, who, although a teacher throughout most of her life, did not start her indigent care, her lifelong work, until she was in her late 60s.
Very
so
good
I would,
point.
I was watching for those two.
Yeah, well, that was a very good point, and I,
I'm not, no criticism.
No. I think it's an interesting thing that I really need to look into and add. I think it's a very good point.
Would this like to be available to anybody who wants them, or?
Excuse me, the slides? Sure, you got them. Mark has them.
Well, I can make sure you do.
Okay. And I teach health and wellness in the older adult in one of our classes, our public health class. So would you be available to
Certainly.
The nursing school?
Certainly. I'll give you my card.
Sure. Thank you very much. Yeah. So we'll contact you.
Yeah, be a privilege. So anything else? So otherwise,
Thank you.
Let me give you one that's not written on here.
One or two, if you have two. Thank you.
Well, thanks for coming, and it was my pleasure, and it's always a pleasure to see my old friends.
Everybody get a chance to sign in?
Yes.
Did you meet Joe?
Oh,
no, surgeon.